So I've just arrived here at Titahi Bay, and this is about half an hour out of Wellington on the Kapiti coast. And it's a really great place to look at some of the local geology. So it's worth coming to Titahi Bay at low tide. I think a lot of people don't realise that underneath the sand of this beach is a fossil forest. Just occasionally, the forest peeks its head above the sand and we can find evidence for it. A 100,000 year old tree stump with growth rings. It's still wooden. I can sort of don't want to damage it particularly, but it's actually quite hard, so it's been preserved in the salt water. It has to have grown here at a time when the sea wasn't swishing around its roots. Sometimes you can come here and there are lots of them and their roots are exposed and they're really, really good. And you can see that in these photos, which I took some years ago. But anyway, that's the first thing to look for if you ever come to Titahi Bay. Now, the next thing I want to do is start to look at the rocks which outcrop at the ends of the beach. So the rocks that we have here are the typical basement rocks of the Wellington region. And so we're starting here at the south end of the beach where we've got a really nice shore platform, a very flat area of rocks that's been eroded by the waves. And what's interesting is if we look in the other direction towards Mana Island, we can see that Mana Island is a really flat-topped island. And the story there is that flat surface was also at sea level once upon a time. And over time, probably 100,000 years, it has been pushed up by earthquakes way above sea level now. Once upon a time, these rocks were laid down horizontally because of various earth movements. They have been tilted up vertically. So now we have a really great place where we can look at the detail of these very ancient rocks. One of the things you'll see straight away if you come here is that you have alternating layers of rock. These pale coloured prominent layers and more grey coloured fragmented broken layers. The paler coloured rocks are sandstones and this grey material is a more fine-grained siltstone. And so the story of these rocks is that off the coast of Gondwana, there were periodic flows of liquid mud and water all mixed up, flowing down the continental slope and spreading across the ocean floor in huge avalanches that sometimes spread out over hundreds of kilometers of area. And these avalanches are represented by these beds. So as that material slowed down and settled down on the sea floor, as it ceased its movement, it started to form a new layer on the seabed. And that is represented by this very sharp line at the base of this sandstone bed. So the sandstone is the coarser material, the little particles settle down first, and then gradually the finer material, which is still floating around in the water, settles down on top of the sandstone. So each of these pairs of sandstone and siltstone represents a single event. And then perhaps hundreds of years later, the next avalanche would come down and create a new layer. So when we look across this area here and we see how thick these deposits are, you can appreciate that it would have taken tens of millions of years to lay down kilometers of this material. So one of the interesting things that you can see in these rocks is this pattern of little holes, and this is called honeycomb weathering, and it is believed to be caused by the action of wind and salty water that splashed over these rocks. And as the air sort of circulates around, it evaporates the salt water, leaves the salt behind, and this expanding crystallizing salt actually gets in the gaps between the sand particles and slowly pushes them apart to create the holes. And once the process starts, it kind of accelerates so that each hole gets bigger and bigger, leaving a lattice structure around it on the outside. So there's another area of rock here, a little bit north of the beach, a few hundred meters north. And you can see again that the layers have been tilted almost vertically. If we look carefully around here, we can find faults where on each side of the fracture line, the beds are clearly displaced. Where it continues on the other side, doesn't quite line up. And another thing that's interesting about this fault, if we follow the line of that water, which is the line of weakness, up to the cliff, you can see that it continues through the cliff. And because it's a line of weakness, it's been easy for the sea to erode out. So it has developed into a sea cave. And now there are some sea stacks where the erosion has washed out the rocks in the gaps and left some freestanding pillars, which one day will also get washed away. This area just north of Titahi Bay is really great to see some classic coastal erosion features. And what's neat about this cave is you can actually walk right through from one end and out the other side. Here again, you can see that this cave has formed right on the line of a fault. So that line of weakness allowed the sea to erode its way and create that cave. So this is my final stop here at Titahi Bay. So a great place to come to see a fossil forest, to see rock layers from a time before New Zealand existed, over 200 million years old, to see faults, to see folds, and to see wonderful coastal erosion features like caves, wave-cut platforms, sea stacks and arches. And the more you look, the more you'll see. So just another one of New Zealand's beautiful landscape and geological locations to explore.